Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Intel Extreme Masters, where James is busy getting ready, or was earlier on actually, because that's an earlier shot. As you can see, he's got lovely hair, beautiful hair. I have no idea what that was. Wow, you guys, really? What are you doing?
We're stroking his beautiful hair.
I'm glad nobody saw that.
Nobody saw that on camera because they weren't quick enough in production, so I think you should redo that.
Why? No.
Okay, it's got very awkward all of a sudden on here, so let's switch it up and talk about the semifinals. Semifinals, boys!
Woo!
Not just
Ready!
Semifinals.
Ready!
The four names in the semifinals. Is this a dream? Can
it
you pinch
me? Well, they are fabulous. Four fabulous players. There's absolutely no doubt about it. Our first match is CJ and Tashiro versus Jadong. Super cool.
Yeah, it's kind of cool.
Yeah.
So crazy.
Kind of cool.
Jadong began his run here with his win against First, and he went 2-1 against First and said that he played poorly. He just played insane, played out of his mind against Gumiho.
Yeah.
Stylistically speaking, it was utterly unique. I mean, just the attack timings, the way he's like rushing for Vipers. Some people use Vipers against Mech, but he's doing Viper timing pushes versus Mech. I've always loved his Zerg versus Protoss, but I haven't seen it for a while. Mm. So I'm eager to see if he has a sort of new ZVP style as well.
Okay. Todd, CJ and Tashiro is definitely one of the top five Protoss in the world right now. He's shown all year what he can do. In fact, over the last 12 months, since he first won Intel Extreme Masters last year in Singapore, he's shown us that he can come to these tournaments, he can compete with whoever you throw at him, and whatever gets thrown at him, he can come out on top. He's been to three finals already. That's a record. Can he make it a fourth?
I think so. You know, Hero plays very well at Intel Extreme Masters every time. He almost never loses to Zerg, and by that I mean he has something like a ridiculous, like a 70% win rate, ranks second on Aligulak in PVZ, which is again, insane. The thing is, he's up against the Dong himself, who's feeding off the strength given by the audience here, who have been, I guess, massively in his favor. So who knows what might happen?
Okay, I've got a question for you as well, just before we head into the semifinals. The Sig Nerd Baller, the MVP of StarCraft II, is available for you to vote right now over on the Facebook.com site. It's facebook.com/IEM. Head over there right now. There are five players in the mix. I just want to know who you think. Just help out the crowd, help out the people that are going to vote. Who do you think deserves that Sig Nerd Baller? It can be someone who's won, it can be someone that went out earlier in the competition. Who do you think? Who stands out for you, Sean?
Jadong.
Okay. That was easy.
Yeah, I'm probably going to have to go with Jadong as well after that series.
Definitely not Kalaris.
Yeah.
Maybe Roddy after the burn. No, seriously, from the players? maybe Rain?
I'm going
full Roddy on this one. Yeah. Rain or Jadong seems like... Yeah. Big choices, good choices.
Yeah. Roddy, I think Roddy, we'll speak for Roddy. I think he's definitely going with Rain. There's no doubt about that. But yeah, you can vote on that right now. It's available for you. Facebook.com/IEM. Go and vote for your Sig Nerd Baller. They get a load of prizes, and they also get those very cool shoes, which I talked to CJ and Tashiro about earlier on the week because he wasn't wearing them, and that's unusual. I thought, where are they? And he said, they're protected in a special case. Well, however you want to keep them, that's fine. But I thought you better than wear them, personally. Hyun wears his all the time.
Yeah, he does. Spider-Hyun. Yeah, they're absolutely pretty cool. His have two flags on, right, for each one of the title they got.
Heroes do, yes. Yeah. Heroes are unique. He has a Brazilian flag and a Singaporean flag on each shoe.
It's pretty cool.
He won both in a row, so yeah, very unique. Okay, so in terms of this semi-final, I know you've all just gone for Jadong as the MVP, but does that mean Jadong advances to the final? Is your faith that good?
Yes.
Okay.
No.
I feel like it's going to be the same story as against Gumiho.
No. Well, hold on. I think you're missing the rules here, Todd. Let me explain this. It's just a one-word answer.
Okay, well, what was the question exactly?
What? Someone come and save us up here. No, I mean, come on, be a bit more descriptive, guys.
I think that...
Why Jadong?
Okay, so first of all, we saw Hero versus Snoot, and we saw that Hero went down two games and pulled it back, was able to adjust, but it was still a very close series.
Yes.
And then I see Jadong as a player who does not do one style. He is very flexible. Snoot tends to play the same way, and that's what allowed Hero to get into it. But if, you know, Jadong plays anywhere at the level of Snoot with the amount of change-ups that Jadong is known for, I absolutely think Jadong is going to win that series.
Okay.
3-1 or 3-0.
Hero is a problem solver. We already saw it in the previous series against Snoot. We saw him go down two games, but then he was able to identify and exactly what he needed to do. Even in the basis of a best of five, Hero is one of the best Protoss on the planet, and I don't see his problem-solving ability going away against someone like Jadong in here, and I think he'll take it 3-1.
Okay. Are you going to stick up for your Protoss?
One word? There is no such thing as a one-word answer in StarCraft 2, Red
okay,
Eye.
Okay, all right, okay.
So I was going to say, back to my points.
When I rudely interrupted
you. It's much like up against Gumiho. My head says Hero in this case, and my heart says Dodong, and I'm probably going to go for my heart once again.
Really? Against the Protoss player? I like this a lot. Feisty stuff as ever from our gentlemen on the panel. It's time now to introduce you to our players who feature in our first semi-final with Rachel.
They've been on this stage a lot this weekend, and now it's time to see who is moving on to the finals. Our first option, by round of applause, please welcome Hero. And his opponent, Mr. J. Dong, 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 dong. They're fired up and ready. I don't want to stand between them. Gentlemen, shake hands. Casters, let's get this game started.
Thank you very much, Rachel, and welcome to the semifinals, the top four of the Intellectual Masters here in San Jose, and what a game we have. But Rotterdam,
yes,
the entire of the desk over there were pretty much favoring Jadong here, and I know we talked a little bit before this. I don't think we're feeling the same.
No, I'm not going to go with the desk on this one. Even though I would love to be wrong, guys, don't get me wrong. I would love to see Jadong play in the finals of the Intel Extreme Masters, especially because it would be his first finals of the Intel Extreme Masters, and this guy's already been there 3 times, you know. Does he really have to be there a 4th time, Sean? But it's going to be so difficult for Jadong. Of course, you know, Jadong is not Snoot. He doesn't play one style, but that's also because he doesn't play that one style as well as Snoot does. And Hero on the other end, he too is a very unpredictable Protoss player. So it's not just that Jadong is going to switch it up. This man, this handsome man, well, they're both very handsome, is going to switch it up as well. And I'm kind of leaning towards Hero, just like I did in the last series.
This is definitely going to be the biggest task of the tournament for Jadong so far. Obviously, it's the furthest he is in the tournament, but going up against Hero, in recent times, Jadong has been struggling against Protoss. He's lost a lot of early games very easily against Protoss. Just look at the last one he played at DreamHack just a week ago. 3-0 versus Sang, game over in 10 minutes. And complete annihilation.
Yeah, and the worst thing about that was that there is about 7 or 8 replays out there how to completely shut Sang down, as Life has done it like twice in a row, barely lost a map. It was 3-0 and 3-1, I believe. Especially the series at BlizzCon, Life just made it look easy. So Jadong didn't look flawless in the matchup, not at all. But he has learned from it. He has defeated first, for instance, in this tournament, and that's already a victory that you can get some courage out of.
Well, one step towards the grand finals. A lot of WCS points on the line here for 2015. Of course, the road to BlizzCon has already started, but Hero looking as the favorite to advance to another final here. He's had a pretty good year, but he's only won one tournament. I know that's kind of a bit negative, but one tournament for this guy. It was very early on in the Intel Extreme Masters last season
at Sao Paulo,
where he won that, but he hasn't won one since. He's been to 2 finals since that, but hasn't lifted a trophy in quite some time, and of course is a big loser from the Intel Extreme Masters World Championship where he went up against SOS over there.
Mm-hmm. And the other one was Kespa Cup against us?
Yes, Kespa Cup was the other one that he's played. He's had 5 top 4s this year, so a very successful year, but I know he'd be loving life if he was able to lift the trophy here in San Jose. And it would be his 3rd Intel Extreme Masters trophy, a record untouched by any other StarCraft player.
It's not going to be easy for any of the 4 that are left right now. Not even for Rain, despite me being such a big fanboy of Rain. But, you know, among these 3, I think all 3 of them are very good shot. And if Bomber would somehow make it past Rain, if he would meet Jadong in the final, then suddenly I think Bomber is the favorite to win it all. But Bomber has his work cut out for him in that series. Yeah. We're going to talk about it later. This one, it's definitely a toss-up. But, you know, Hero, in my eyes, is a small favorite. But in the last series, you know, I also thought, if you go over all the results, if you compare the results over the last few months, Jadong and Gumiho, then you would be out of your mind to say that Jadong is the favorite or that you think that Jadong is going to win it. But on tournaments like this, on a stage like this, the results of the online cups and stuff, they don't really matter. Other things matter. You know, your experience, how you keep it calm, the mind games can get into your opponent's head. And that's why I favor Jadong over Gumiho in that series. And that's not because I think he's a better player right now. That's just because I think overall he's a more, you know, slightly more complete and mostly things that come down to outside of game elements like mechanics and stuff.
Okay, all right. So we've established that Hero is pretty much the favorite coming into this when it comes to prediction-wise, but let's talk about Jadong. What does he need to do to be able to beat Hero on a stage like this, in front of the audience like this, to go to his first Intel Street Masters final?
I think the most important thing is scouting, Sean. And I know that's such a generic answer, not very exciting, but it's just important that Jadong does not get caught off guard. That
he has Hero the maps as well. You think this plays into fact with what you're saying?
I think King Sejong Station is a map that plays out pretty straightforward. It's also a map where it can be difficult for Zerg to attack, don't get me wrong. But if Hero commits to something, he has done a lot of Blink Stalker attacks on that map, by the way. If he would do something like that, as soon as Jadong identifies something, I believe that he's always capable of dealing with it because he's so smart. Just the lack of scouting has really been holding him back in this matchup, and it's gonna have to be different this game.
Overall, with the map pool here, before we do get rid of it, how do you think this kind of favors the players? Do you think this is more a Hero favored map? Do you think there's kind of momentum that Jadong can pick up from the very get-go on the earlier maps?
King Sejong is very important. I'm afraid if Jadong loses that one, it's going to be very difficult, because I feel that merry-go-round, even though it's a very difficult map for Protoss to go up to three bases, it's a very good map for Protoss to stay on two bases. And we all know that Hero loves his two base attacks and that he's great in executing them as well. So we will see. I think the first two maps, I mean, it's very hard to read too much into it. It will all come down to momentum. I truly think this is a series that comes down to momentum. The very first build order openings, you know, will the Oracles or DTs do a lot of damage, or the gateway units? But for Jadong, it's just most important that he goes into this with a clear mind, and you know, he has to be prepared for everything, literally.
Eye of the Tiger here for Jadong as we're very close to starting the first game of the semi-finals here. Four players remain to fight for that trophy we just saw. CJ Hero, as much as he may be favorite to win this, he's got to play his best, otherwise Jadong will capitalize, he'll pick up momentum, he'll get confident from the crowd cheering him, and this could end very different than a lot of people expect him, but we'll see how this is going to shape up. Of course, still a best of five until we reach the finals where it is a best of seven.
Such a great series, Sean. I'm really excited for this one. Both of them are very likable guys. Both of them are icons in StarCraft 2 as well. Even this man, he may not be as popular as the other one, but he's still a world-class player. He's a two-time IEM champion. Give it up for Hero.
And down here to the bottom right-hand side on King Sejong Station, looking for his first Intel Street Masters Finals. The Red Zerg playing for Team Evil Geniuses. It's Jadong. Of course, the crowd massively behind him, but can he actually put in the results here to reward their faith?
Often he does, Sean. The louder they are, the harder he goes.
He plays.
The better he performs in general. We'll see where this goes. First pylon goes down on the low ground for Hero. Could be a Forge opening. I'd be a little bit surprised if we see that. Jadong is definitely a Zerg that likes to go hatch first very, very frequently in this matchup. But this is one of the maps where most Zergs are pretty hesitant about it. Of course, it's a two-player map, and if you decide to open up with a Forge, it will always go, you'll always find your opponent's natural immediately.
Well, so far in this tournament, Hero's had a pretty successful one, to be honest. He went through the qualifiers, as we've all talked about, though the qualifiers are very difficult. He aced his groups with a 2-0 versus Super, 2-0 versus Bomber, and of course, a good quarter-final. But here we have a very early Forge Rotterdam coming out from Hero.
He's gonna try it, man.
The overload misses the probe as well, so Jadong does not see the threat of this.
Well, this is not the start I think you're looking for Jadong. Of course, it will still come down to how many drones is he going to pull? Will he be able to block the cannons from going down? But I am pretty damn certain that Hero is gonna drop a pylon and is going to drop a bunch of cannons, and that's just not the start of the series that you're wishing for. There goes pylon number one, there goes pylon number two. Does Jadong? Yeah, he must know. I mean,
well, he's put a pawn and pulled down. He's moving his overlord across. He sees it. He's got a drone, but this cannon rush is going to take place. It's way too late, and already Jadong starting from a very difficult position. There is the three pylon wall, and here we are going to have a cannon built. The probe may even escape from this as well. very difficult situation. Hero has found himself in a great starting point.
He's sending out another drone, Sean. Like, one of them, of course, is going to replace the hatchery that he's going to lose in his natural. But where's the other one? If he's just going to take it in the middle of the map, I kind of like that. I have cannon rushed a lot in my days. I'm not proud of it, Sean. Those are my youth sins. But I have been there way more than I'm willing to admit, actually. But I always hated it when Zerg players would just take hatcheries in different positions, especially if I made big commitments. I think it's super important that Hero got that pylon down, because if that is just a hatchery, then you have a weird game, but as a Protoss, your Nexus is still very late, and you're still not too happy. But I think now Hero is quite happy.
Well, he is happy as the Nexus has been planted down Gateway as well, as he knows that there aren't any units out at the current time, and of course, Jadon looking to protect this hatchery down south, so if he was to lose that, he'd be in terrible position. Still trying to re-expand to the center of the map here, but probes still being consistent and very annoying here for Jadon.
Yep, well, two Zerglings are going to usher these probes away. Both probes are here, actually. I mean, I kind of like this by Jadon. Now it's 4 minutes and 30 seconds that this hatchery goes down. That is, of course, a solid 35, 40 seconds later than it would normally go down. The natural from Jadon is a solid 40, 50 seconds later as well than it normally would be, because he had to cancel it, he had to replace it. But in the end, if you take a look at the Nexus, only the Nexus halfway down. Gateway is about to finish up, but it's not really done yet. I think it's a successful start for Hero, don't get me wrong, but I think that Jadon is far from out of this one. There's definitely stuff he can work with.
Right, well, an Overlord spots down the wall. Drone's being transferred down to this bottom base here. What do you think about the difficulties of these expansions and holding them against any potential aggression? Does he have a problem with this? What are some of the problems with these expansions? Surely, I mean, it's not as simple as can be.
No, it's not that simple, but one of the biggest issues is what we just saw. Transferring workers is normally something that Zerg players do very frequently. Yep. You know, you saturate your main and then you start transferring workers. Now these workers have to travel a solid 10, 15 seconds longer than they normally have to. And that really eats you up in the long run as a Zerg player. And of course, the one in the middle of the map, you know, it's very easy for Hero to attack. With a strong two-base timing, he literally walks straight up to it. It's easy to force field off as well in certain areas. So it will all come down to Jadon has to scout. Okay, this actually I don't think it's too bad, because Stargate is in general slows the game down a little bit, and that might allow Jadon to get everything going. And the last thing, Sean, that we have to mention is creep spread. It's not that easy to reach creep spread all the way to the middle of the map as it would normally be to just go to your natural or your third base.
Well, Jadon has started work on his creep spread, but doesn't want to fly an Overlord over that cannon. He did have an Overlord on the natural of Hero and has spotted the Stargate immediately, so he knows exactly what he's playing against. And upon that and gathering that information, he has decided to add on additional queens, build a layer instantly. At this point, does he want to add on spore crawlers? Does he want to go up to Hydralis Den?
This is a layer before Zergling Speed, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, then I think it's it will most likely just be a Hydralisk indeed. I don't think he's going to do anything else.
Well, I guess the one flip side of all of this is, as far out into the open as this third hatchery is, it's also technically closer towards Hero if he gets creep spread pushing from that third. He's not that far away from Hero. And with a heightened speed of layer, we're going to have a faster Hydralis Den coming out.
You're 100% right, but let's not forget about these pylons that are still up in the natural. That's something that eventually you want to take care of. As Hero's throwing down three more gateways, now Jadon starts making a bunch of Zerglings. It's very important, because I would love to see if Hero will ever be able to find these gateways on the north side of Hero's base, because I don't think he will. And with plus one on the way, that's something that Jadon should not underestimate.
That's right. That's absolutely right. This Overlord is not going to get the gateway scouts.
I think the Oracle's in the main base, correct? See how much work it got done. Seems like it got a bunch of workers. Not too many, but a few.
Six workers killed off there. They are being replaced. Carapace is the upgrade chosen from the Evolution Chamber. And the Hydralis Den has been placed down here from Jadon, who's starting to get a feel of this game. Doesn't really know about the gateway count, but he's about to move over to the other side of the map to see that the third base is down.
Yeah, now Hero, Jadon, of course, has to make a very, very important decision. Is he going to go all out trying to cancel this? Well, he has a lot of Zerglings, but the Oracles are so fantastic against Zerglings. The Zealot will get picked off, but it doesn't matter because the DPS of the Oracle is just too high. And these moments are so important in PvZ. If you're a Hero right now, Sean, you're loving life because you just know my opponent made a bunch of Zerglings and he didn't get what he was looking for.
Jadon still not cleared out those two pylons supported by that cannon hit. Could come into play shortly here for Heroes. He's adding on a lot of gateways. He's finished with plus one attack. He's got Blink on the way.
I like that you mentioned that, Sean, because that is actually such a risky move by Jadon. He didn't even make a Roach one either. So if Hero would have just made like one Stargate and then dropped 7 gaze in his main and would have just all in, this game would have been absolutely over. There's no way you can defend without a Roach one.
Well, the real units now are just coming out here for Jadon. 6 Hydralis, he doesn't really have anything else. We have the pylon in between the bases and also a sentry push with the Mothership Core towards the central field. You know, if Hero's pushing this middle, he can also kind of hold Jadon there while building Zealots and putting them into the main base. So a bit of tricky situation that Jadon has to address. Yeah. Cannon down, pylon still there.
This is kind of weird. So far, he's just using this to clean our creep. We have seen this before, Sean, and you mentioned it in the recap as well. I mentioned it in the game. After he had to use recall against Snoot, that's why he didn't have Photon Overcharge at home. And now again, he's kind of playing with fire. The Monster Core is going to escape for now. But no Photon Overcharge anymore. And for now, it's just a bunch of sentries against Hydralisk. But I don't think that Jadon is going to go all out with it. What's the Hydra count at? It's not that intimidating, is it? It's like 12 or something?
Yeah, 15. That's a pretty decent amount. But there are a lot of force fields.
Yeah, I'm not feeling it.
Like, not that far away either here. With some good place force field and catching units off guard, I think Hero should be okay here.
And Blink is a little bit quicker this time as well, I feel. I'm not feeling this attack by Jadon. I don't think he should go too far in. Oh. The force fields are good so far. Don't let too many Hydra squeeze through. Just 4 or 5 at a time. That's perfect.
Yeah, great composure here from Hero. Sure, he's losing a couple of units, but he's really kept this back in at bay. He does have a few more force field. A couple of links do slip through here, getting close to this.
Hydra's Hero
still remaining, but remember he does have Blink. I don't think we've seen any units blink until this just very second. Guardian Shield is up as well, and he continues to warp in. Plus 2 attack has been stopped, by the way, as the Forge has been turned offline, but Hero seems to be able to hold on. And of course can rebuild that pile, and he's going to blink forward and pick off the rest of these units.
Yeah, in the end, that is a pretty good victory there for CJ and his Hero, if you ask me. Lost a few sentries early on, but as soon as he started blinking, as soon as he realized, like, hey, I got 1,000 minerals in the bank, I should warp in a few more Stalkers, I think that started going really well for him. Right now, Jadon is stacking up to Hive, but if I was Hero, I would never give him the time to ever get a Hive out.
13 Hydralis are the answer to these units right there, but they're not in play yet. There's only a couple of Zerglings. Force fields here can be very frustrating. Ooh. A huge, crazy blink coming out from Hero there. I don't even know what that was. He blinks forward into a bunch of Zerglings. And then force fields come around to actually try to assist these units. But that was insane from Hero. That was not good. That was not worth it. And he lost a lot.
Yeah, he lost a bunch of Stalkers over there. Man, he's wiping in like 9 or 10 Stalkers at a time even. He's very, very serious about his aggression. He's just going to do it all over again, Sean. This time, there are not too many Zerglings to jump into. But more and more Hydralisks are starting to stream in. I still like this game for Hero, but he's being a little over-eager. I would like to take him a small, or maybe take a chill pill, as Johan Mello likes to say, and just back off, recollect yourself, and then do the same thing all over again, because he's just going all the way in.
Well, he did manage to pick off about 20-ish workers there, and he's really crippled Jadon's economy. He's resorting to build roaches at this moment, trying to get roach speed, but plus 2 attack Stalkers, a great lead for Hero, who's kind of established it from the very beginning of this game, and he's looking to close it out. And some good blink control should be able to break the forces here from Jadon to take game to 1. He blinks forward once again and is going to pick off the remaining of these units slowly but surely. If not with this wave, the next one should be able to do it. Jadon trying to hold his stance on the high ground here.
It's really funny because Hero is still winning this game, but he's definitely not executing his attack as flawlessly as we normally see him do. But I guess it's okay because he picked off so many drones, like you mentioned as well. So even if these trades are not the best trades that you would ever made or the most efficient trades as a Protoss player, that doesn't matter because for every 10 Stalkers you warp in, he may get 4 or 5 Roaches, and that's just not going to be enough in the long haul.
And there we go. Jadon still trying to hold on to the center. If he can, that's great. But there's a lot of Stalkers here and there's a lot more on the way as well. And he gets pushed back. Another round of Hydralis coming in. Oh, no, great counterplay from Hero, too. If he swings around from the back, forcing units to go defend inside the main base, going to be too difficult for Jadon. Down on units, down on economy. And Hero looking to take map number 1 of this best of 5. And he's looking like he's going to win a second.
Yeah, in a pretty convincing manner as well. Blinding Cloud is frustrating, but Jadon, or excuse me, Heroes is going to blink forward one more time on top of the remaining Hydralis, the remaining Roaches. And there we have it. GG is called. Hero wins game 1 on King Sejong Station. A little cheeky smile, Apollo. You saw that?
I did see that smile, and I think that's just a smile of, yep, I still pretty much believe I can beat this guy. As Hero starts with that cannon rush there, gains an advantage, continues the advantage to the mid game, and then just finishes it off
instantly.
Yep, couple of interesting moments there. Of course, the Oracle getting six drones in the main six is a little more than you normally want to lose against a single Oracle. Then it was the first Zergling counter that didn't get the cancel on the Nexus. And after that, we had the Zergling Hydra attack that also didn't get the damage on. That's just three or four small things. But on this level of StarCraft 2, three or four things that don't go your way, that means that a player like CGN's Hero is just going to win because that's all he needs.
All right, well, before we get into game number two between these two players, we are going to take a quick commercial break. But when we come back, we'll see which way this is going to go. Welcome back here to the top four of the Intel Extreme Masters San Jose. Hero currently leads 1-0 versus Evil Geniuses Jadong in a series that could be very one-sided here unless we see some of that magic that we've seen earlier on in this tournament from Jadong.
He has definitely shown us some magic throughout the days, and this is possible on the second map, which I believe is still going to be Merry-Go-Round, a map where it's extremely difficult for Protoss to secure their third base. Going up to three bases is, living hell, so to speak. It's very wide open. There's almost no solid way to do it without being pretty far behind. So that means that most Protoss players go for two bases, which is, of course, something that we truly love to do. And for Jadong, it's just all about scouting and identifying how that is going to go.
What do you think Jadong's thinking about right now? You can see him kind of staring down. Is he just patiently waiting? You know him as a player. Is he waiting? Is he getting a little bit angry inside?
No, I don't know him that well personally. He's super friendly with me. He's always super nice. But, to say that I know what goes on through his mind, that would just be speculating. I think he's just really thinking about merry-go-round. What's the best way to approach this? Just think about all the things that he has seen from CGN's Hero and what to expect. And maybe like over one or two things of the previous map, just be like, why did I do that? Why did I do this? And why did it play out the way it did?
Well, Hero, looking to see if he can attend another grand final of the Intel Extreme Masters. He's reached four semifinals so far
in
his career.
It's actually sick.
Incredible. He's had five top fours throughout this year. He's played in two finals. An incredible record from this guy. Easily top five Protoss worldwide. Going up to see if he can take out Jadong here in the semifinals. Is up here to the top left is that very map. And there's a blue Protoss playing for Team ECJ. It's Hero! The sickest of intros, buddy.
Oh, good. 6 o'clock position of merry-go-round. I know a lot of you guys came out here to San Jose to support him. Be as loud as you can for the one and only J-Dong. A lot of J-Dong fans in the house, Sean.
A lot of J-Dong fans worldwide, Roddy.
If In Control was here, he'd be proud. I think Jeff is proud anyway, because spoiler alert, the Seahawks did win today, I believe.
They did?
Yes. Boo, no Seahawks fans here.
Nice. All right, so pylon inside the main base here for Hero, looking at a gateway expand, but you did start to tap onto a little bit of the strategy when it comes to playing on merry-go-round. This map can be very difficult for Protoss players to take the third base, which does push them quite often into these two base attacks. You think that's the way the Hero's gonna approach this? Like some form of gateway attack like he did versus Snoot earlier?
Yep.
Some form of a mortal attack that we've seen so frequent from Protoss players here?
I mean, we shouldn't forget that what he did earlier today against Snoot, Snoot played right into his hands because yeah. Snoot wanted to counter something that Hero was not doing. And that could have truly played out in both ways because if Hero actually marches across the map and he has no wall of and all the Zergling streaming to his main, then Hero could be in a little bit of trouble. But the way that played out, that was just perfect for Hero. It couldn't have been any better. Snoot tries to be aggressive against a Protoss that opens up with five gates. Well, that is a dream scenario for a Protoss player. I think this is going to be like something that Sun often does, as Johan likes to say. You put on some initial pressure, whether it is with four gates or a Stargate in some gateways, and then you indeed follow it up with Immortal Sentries. I'd be so surprised if CG Enter's Hero just takes his sweet time over here and goes up to three bases and macros it up. Like, I can't imagine a world where he does that.
Well, let's hope J-Dong's thinking along similar lines here. He's decided to open up Hatchery first here, so he's saying, I hope you aren't going to cannon rush me again. I don't want that situation to happen, and he has gotten away with that. But he has decided to go for a very early extractor here. He's going to be able to get that Zergling speed nice and early on, try to control the field a little bit more, control the center of merry-go-round to prevent the probe moving out, to prevent the pylon from going down, to maybe pick off a Zealot or Stalker. Obviously, because controlling that's going to be very comfortable against these type of aggressive plays we could see out from Hero. And already, we have a Zealot marching across the other side of the map, which has been picked up by J-Dong's Overlord.
Yep. This probe is going to scout the main base. The most important thing that Hero wants to see is if an extractor has been taken, and he's going to see that there is indeed an extractor on the way. That speed will be researched so that he shouldn't go too crazy with his gateway aggression. The Zealot might be able to be annoying, maybe pick up a drone, maybe the Mothership Core is going to fly to the main base and pick off a drone. Yep. Other than that, I don't think Hero is going to be able to do all that much. Where do you think J-Dong is going to expand, Sean? I want to hear this from you. Do you think it's going to be at 6 o'clock, but then a little bit more to the middle, or at 4 o'clock?
I think he'll go 4 o'clock to the right-hand side here.
I think you're onto something, and I think that I would prefer that as well, because especially with that high ground over here in between these two both players, if Hero would go for a two-base attack, he's so close to that third base if Hero takes it at 6 o'clock, but we'll see.
All right, so Zergling's trying to get a bit of a feel out for this game here, going to try and get up the ramp, and they are going to get up the ramp, one of them at least. And he's going to poke forward, sees the Nexus, obviously, saw that before with the Overlord, but he's going to go inside the main base, sees two probes moving down. He obviously avoids them, going to have a look inside the main base. Does he see the sentry? No, he doesn't, but he sees the pylon at the back, nothing there, sees the sentry, so he knows exactly all the information in this game has been present, it's been spotted, he's seen the Zealot, seen the Mothership Core, seen the sentry. See no additional structures though, but maybe the Overlord on the natural has done here, because that's where they all are.
Two more gateways going down. So far, it's not really a big of a tell. The Forge went down after the Zergling got picked off. So, where are you going to take this? It could still be a Blink Stalker attack. He could potentially like pretend like he's going up to three bases, but then just never saturate the base and still go for a big gateway attack. Something that, like I always say, Alicia has done quite a few times in his days. And I like that build. Well, I think it's a very good build to trigger your opponent with.
J-Dong's chosen the fast layer. He spotted the gateways on the natural. Didn't see if there was a Forge or not, but either way, he's playing without a Roach One. It is a little bit risky, but he does have Zergling speed. He's scouting the right-hand side of this map to see if there is a probe, to see if there is a pylon, to give information on if he needs to be able to build units. But Hero, with a great counter scout here, moves in with the Mothership Core, sees that fast layer once again.
Okay.
And has chosen the robotics facility upon spotting this.
Interesting. Interesting choice to go for the robotics facility, because I feel like if he really wanted the robotics facility, he could have done it a little bit quicker. This is 6 minutes and 40 seconds. It's relatively late, but of course he does have plus one on the way, so...
Well, maybe it could be a warp prism to get in there before the Hydralis are out. Immortals is late-ish, right?
Yeah, but maybe it's like an in-between... Yeah, no, I totally agree with you. Immortals are going to be very late, especially against this quick layer. Warp Prism, I think, is too wonky. I don't think you can go for it. And I also think you should have done it quicker if that's what you wanted to go for. So I don't know. Maybe it's like some pseudo pressure now, and then he's still going to follow it up with a big Immortal push. That's what I think he's going to do. Okay. He's going to force out as many units as he can, maybe try to slow Jadong down, and meanwhile pump up Immortals. I don't know. It's a Robo Bay.
Oh, Robo Bay. Very interesting here. That's key information that Jadong does not know about. He's going to poke to the front here. Of course, the Robotics Bay coming in so early. We're going to see a two-base Colossus push, surely, at this point. But we'll come back to that in a moment, as there are a lot of roaches. And oh, Jadong almost got in there to maybe pick up the scout of this. It is inside the main base.
And that, I mean, this is a pretty good move by Hero, because he scouts a quick layer and he's like, hey, you're going quick Hydralisk. You know what? Yeah. Instead of going for an Immortal Boost, I'm going to rush up to Colossus. But you know, the sixth play for Jadong, if the answer is, and it often is in this game called StarCraft 2, the Roach.
The Roach. I knew you were going to say that, Roddy. I read your minds. There's a lot of them out right now. And of course, a Colossus push could be a little bit difficult to use against this, but three Zealots and a Warp Prism, I think they were spotted there, or they at least will be in a second.
Colossus are very, very bad against Mass Roach. Two base Colossus against Mass Roach and three bases is not going to work.
This is 46 drones. It's very low for Jadon, just trying to build up a lot of these Roaches, attacking and defending at the same time.
He's going to have to worry about the Warp Prism, right? Was it just Zealots in that?
Yeah, but he does have Roaches there.
Then he's fine. He does have to worry at all, Sean. Why am I lying to the people at home?
Well, there's a lot of Roaches, and they are getting picked up slowly. There's an Immortal that's squeezed out and a second one, so maybe the Robotics Bay has been kind of cancelled in kind of Hero's mind upon seeing the Mass Roaches, which you've identified is not ideal really against this. So five more drones. Warp Prism still around.
I think Hero's a little bit confused now. He's like, man, I want to make this Colossus push against you with Hydralisk, but then if you're making Roaches, you know what? Then I'm just going to Immortal all in you. And now he's going to spot this Hydralisk then after all. He already has the Robotics Bay. He may just make one Colossus, but I think he's going to go, there we go. He's going to start up one Colossus after the two Immortals.
Yeah.
And now this attack looks a little bit more intimidating again. Even though supply-wise, it looks good for Jadong, I kind of like this game for Hero.
All right. Well, looks like Jadong is waiting to use the Hydralisk then here, but there is a bit of a push down here from Hero. Still, very low probe count. This Nexus, remember that there's also two gateways finishing. Yeah. Don't know how much this Nexus is actually going to be used in this game. Jadong sees that the Nexus was implanted, but still, he's adding on Hydralisks. If he drones right now, he's in trouble, especially because these Zealots are slowing him down on this right-hand side.
Yeah, I'm very worried for Jadon, especially because I don't think making Hydralisk on a bad economy if there are Colossus on the field is ever a good choice. Like, I would much rather just go ham on my Roaches, and I know Force Fields good cancel there. I know Force Fields are intimidating for Roaches, but I would still try to win this game with a Roach around whatsoever.
Well, Jadon was going to lose these Roaches, but he scouts the Colossus here. There's still no Spire. It's Roach Hydralisk alone currently, with the Warp Prism from Hero still being excellent. And this push out is going to have plus two attack. It's going to have Blink. It's got the Colossus supported by a couple of Immortals. And this seems like a very well executed push from Hero, potentially. Yeah.
I would have much rather seen Jadong make Mass Roach and also get Tunneling Claws and Burrow. He already has Roach speed, so getting Tunneling Claws and then Burrow, I think, is a much better choice. Roaches are so much cheaper than Hydralisk. As Johan said, you know, only 75 minerals, 25 gas. He could have been maxed out on Roaches now.
Oh, these Roaches, though, they're coming into the natural, and they're going to be able to snipe a Colossus here. And the Colossus trying to dance around. It's very low naturally. No, the Roaches don't get it. But at the same time, Hero's push, where exactly is it? It's having to come back. It's been recalled back.
Colossus.
Actually, by the Roach call. Another Colossus. And this is the big unit damage dealer here, especially with so many Hydralisks in this game. One of them goes down.
At the same
time, Jadong is on the third Nexus.
Man.
And from what it seemed like a well-designed push coming out from Hero, Jadong goes for this counterplay. And he brings the Nexus down. He's looking good against this.
Yeah, he's actually starting to look very good. Of course, he sacrificed quite a few Roaches there, but it's safe to say that was for the greater good. A couple of Zerglings jumping on top of these Immortals as well. Look at these Hydralisks doing work, Sean.
Oh, they want to get close to these Immortals, but Force back off, keeping them at bay here, and if he...
I think Jadong should go back. I mean, I know Hydras are slow and stuff, but I feel like he did so well already. Most of the Colossus had died.
Hero's punishing him here for moving out so far with these units, and Jadong can't really escape versus these Blink Stalkers, and he does lose quite a lot there. Probably going to blink forward again and pick off a couple more of these units. Is Jadong going to be able to muster enough of units to defend against this? He's lost the Colossus, so...
Oh, that's a good snipe. That's a really good snipe, getting this pylon. Should try to get the probe as well. The probe is going to die. Not a forward blink. He has to be careful with these forward blinks. He cannot afford to lose Stalkers. He's really not that rich. He doesn't have that many.
Yeah,
and the Warp Prism died as well, correct?
Yes, I think it did.
That is such an important snipe on that pylon. That gives Jadong so much time, Sean, because as a Protoss, you never never won a deck without a Prism or a Pylon.
Jadong's going to launch a counterattack again with just circling to the left-hand side while trying to build up his Roach Hydro count to deal with this push. This may bring Hero back. Hero looking to close this one out very soon. A two-base attack that's been developing for a long time in this game. Quite a few Roach and Hydros chasing around. But Zergling's a counterattack as well. He goes right into the main base. He splits to the natural as well. Excellent play here from Jadong, and Hero caught in the middle of the map. Does he attack? Does he defend?
The floodgates are open, Sean. Zergling streaming up the ramp there. Hero is going to lose so much of his economy, and Jadong is just playing this so well. How did I ever doubt the Dong in this game? Only 38 probes remaining. Merry-go-round, he counted
and
so well
go
with the roaches.
He's going to attack now. He's coming in from all sides. He forces the recoil. A couple of Stalkers actually don't go back with the Mothership Core, but Hero has been pushed back to two bases, trying to rebuild his Colossus, trying to rebuild his workers, and Jadong is sitting pretty across four bases with map control. Better workers, better army.
Man, Jadong did a phenomenal job this game in playing Zerg, and with that I mean building units, building drones, building units, building drones. Slowly but steady, he kept working on his own economy. At first, he looked really poor, but he became richer and richer. He's going to go in for it. He doesn't have to do this, but he feels confident enough that he's going to be able to even up the series over here, Sean. And will he be able to do that?
Well, we'll find out here. Is Hero putting up a last stance here? He's got a lot of damage dealers with the Colossus Animortar, but slowly but surely, these units are being worn down here as Jadong loses quite a few of these units. But still, he's damaged the economy. It's very difficult for Hero to rebuild what he's lost while Jadong still has a high economy.
Army supply right now. Hero must be ahead, by the way. No, actually, Jadong just squeezed out a few more units because Hero doesn't really have a whole lot of probes, of course, so most of his supply is actually
another aggressive blink here from Hero as Jadong launches his Zerglings forward to pick off 3, 4, 5 Stalkers.
Man, lost the Cybercore. It's so frustrating for a Hero. He can't warp in any Stalkers.
Two Colossus here now. If they can be protected by four sentries that are getting warped in to help with force fields around, maybe they can do damage. But the Roach count is high, the Hydra's count is high. And if Jadong just continues to hold versus the obvious push, the obvious aggression, he moves his Zealot into position here not to let that happen again.
Good timing there on that Colossus. 12 more Roaches. I really like this because he picked off all the Immortals in that previous engagement near the main base of Hero. So this is a perfect moment, Sean, to make Roaches again. Roaches so good against Colossus. If they can get close enough, and as long as there are no Immortals, most of the time the Roaches do get close
enough. And Jadong's going to come around for the full surround from the right-hand side and the left. He's going to try and go all the way around this army, and this looks like a pretty big surround. If he pulls this off, he wins the game. Here we go from the left. He's coming in. The force was on the right hand side, three of them, but they're slipping through these units. The Hydralisks on the left are going to do so much damage. Hero's push is not going to work, and Jadong is going to tie this series up. Excellent play from Jadong, excellent counterattacks, and the last Colossus goes down, and GG is called. Jadong ties the series up 1-1.
Beautiful, beautiful game by Jadong. Really nothing else to say about that game. I loved it from start to finish. At a certain point, I was a little bit worried because I felt he was too poor to make Hydralisk. But even in that phase in the game, he did believe in the power of the Roach as well, because that Roach run by, that's truly where things started to become beautiful for Jadong. Killed a lot of workers, slowed the push down from CJ into Zero. During all that, he was droning up a little bit, and then afterwards he had enough Hydralisk and Roaches, and I love how he kept switching Hydras, Roaches, Zerglings, kept rotating around while taking an extra base and saturating them. Awesome play.
Brilliant play, and that is game on. And we'll go into that game number 3 in a couple of moments once we come back from this commercial break. welcome back to the Intel Extreme Masters top four here. As we go into the semi-finals, Hero 1-1 with Evil Genius's Jadon. Do you think the pressure started to mount on this guy?
No.
I think he's still calm and composed up there.
I think he's still pretty calm and composed up there, Sean. That was a very difficult map. Merry-go-round is not easy for a pros player. We did see him attempt to take a third base on one moment in the game. And that's probably because he got slowed down quite a bit. But we saw how difficult it is to defend against that kind of stuff. It's so wide open. You have to position your Protoss units in so many different locations at once. And Protoss units are very powerful units, but they often need each other's backup. They complement each other all very well, but by themselves, they're often not very good. So I think it was a map issue. I still think Hero has a lot of confidence going into the remaining games. But for Jadon, that was an awesome game. That was just the type of StarCraft game that you know Jadon loves to play.
Yeah, he loves to play that. And I think it's a great confidence booster for him, knowing that he has been struggling against Protoss recently to beat a player of Hero's caliber on stage in that type of manner. He's hoping that he can continue the march forward towards the finals here. Of course, the winner of this goes to the grand finals here in San Jose. And Roddy believes in a thing called the Dong, as he's hoping to see him do well here. But we'll see, as this is, of course, two very, very talented and skilled StarCraft II players. The next map is, do you remember?
Catalina, maybe? Catalina or Nimbus.
I trust your memory. I'm going to go with your instinct.
I think it might actually be Nimbus. I think Nimbus is 4 and Catalina is 5. But it doesn't matter. We are not there yet. We should definitely just focus on game number 3, which is going to be played on... Ah, that's what you were asking. I thought you were asking like the map after this one.
No, this next one, buddy.
King, I think this is Nimbus, but I could be mistaken.
We'll see.
I think I'm pretty damn sure it's Nimbus. If it's Nimbus, then well, let's just wait until I start speculating and analyzing a map that is not even going to happen.
It's been a pretty aggressive series so far between these two players. Do you think that favors Hero or Jadon more?
I think Jadon likes the hectic games, though. Like, he's always been a player that excels when it comes to crisis management. You know, when silly things happen, when you have to worry about more than just one or two things going on in the game, those are Jadon type of games. Hero's also a player that pretty much excels in crazy stuff, but often when he's the one dictating the pace of the game, and obviously as a pros player, you never want to be running after the facts.
Crowd getting behind Jadon here in the SAP Center here in San Jose. Thank you guys for coming down. I think he heard you because he's smiling there.
Cheeky smile.
Cheeky smile from Jadon. Knows that everyone here is supporting him, hoping him to go through to the finals. But now he's got to really translate that energy that he grabs from the crowd into the game, focusing on all these different types of aggression, different types of plays that we could see come out from Hero. It's a beautiful stadium, this Rotterdam. Maybe one day when we can play hockey, we can play here properly. But I don't think we can. I can't even ice skate. That's a problem.
Well, there isn't such a thing as field hockey. It's very popular in Holland. But...
Okay, let's play that, man. We'll bring the European style over here.
I'm not sure if I'm the biggest fan of that either. Let's just stick to computer games, Sean.
I think we have to. That's the only thing we're good at, apparently. And maybe a little bit of talking. All right, here we go. Game number 3 between Hero and Jadon. Currently tied up 1-1. The player who wins this, of course, is going to go into match point, a very comfortable position to be in going into the potential final game. Red versus blue, evil versus good. Let's jump in. The third map is going to be Nimbus here, Rotterdam. Take us away with the first player introduction.
On the left bottom side, we have the two-time IEM champion. He is looking for his fourth final appearance. Give it up for CJ Enters Hero. He could be my hero, baby.
He is my hero, baby. And up here to the top right-hand side is the red Zerg player. This player really needs no introduction, but he's got to have one apparently, because that's the rules of introducing games of StarCraft. As the red Zerg player playing for Team Evil Geniuses, it's Jadon!
I really like Rachel's introduction on stage. She's like, Jadon, da-dum-dum-dum. I thought that was cute.
That was cute, Rachel. Been nailing those introductions on stage this weekend, Rotty.
Yeah, man, she's still got the passion.
She's got the passion. All right, Jadon looking very serious. As, of course, this tournament going to get more difficult with an expected rain in the finals here if he can go through Bomber in our second semi-final that could very well go either way, but a lot of people are looking at rain to do so. But here, Nimbus. What are some of the main strategies here that we see very often? It looks like Hero's, you know, looking at a Nexus first himself, but more so than the build. Talk to me about the strategy. What is very popular? Is it a slow game to drag it out long?
Yeah, Stargate player, I think for, goes for most Protoss players. This is really a, such a good Stargate map because it's such a large map. In general, it's very hard to scout to figure out where the Zerg units are if you rely on your ground army. But if you fly around with Phoenixes or an Oracle first and then drop some revelations later on, you will always have a very good idea what your opponent is doing. And let's be honest, like if Protoss has all the freedom in the world and they can go up to four bases, now number four is definitely the problem here. Three bases, definitely not a problem. You know, this is not merry-go-round. Protoss can go up to three bases. Base number four is often an issue, and you have to figure out what you have to worry about, and that's why starting off with a Stargate is often a very good choice. I'd be kind of surprised if he doesn't play Stargate. I'm going to go that far.
All right, we'll follow that then as we get closer to seeing that come true. We are going to see Jedungum three hatcheries here. So three hatchery versus the Nexus first, two very slow openers when it comes to action and aggression here, as both players focusing very heavily on the amount of income they can gather from the get-go. When you see these two builds shape up against each other, is the one that favors one more than the other?
I like Double Hatch a lot more than Nexus first. Of course, it's not something that Hero can really do a whole lot about. You know, as a Protoss player, you can hardly build two Nexus before you build Gateway. I mean, you can try, but you're just going to die against the first 12 Sweetlings that run across the map. But this is kind of what you want as Hero. The reason why you would go Double Hatch before Pooh is just to get as much economy going as soon as possible.
Yeah.
And of course, you don't want to worry about any kind of crazy early game pressure. But the moment you know there won't be any early game pressure because it's Nexus first, you're like, cool, now I can drone. Does it work? No?
Yeah, no, that was great.
Thank you, Sean. You're a real friend.
Yeah, you see if you can fit some more of those in throughout the rest of this cast. We'll see where we go.
Oh, you just never want to work with me again, do you? No.
No, it's brilliant, mate. You keep it up. All right, so the Cybernetics Core is going to complete here for CJ Heroes. He pokes inside the main base. He's kind of now figured out that he is playing against the three hatchery. So is he going to go to Stargate? Yes, he is. So Rotterdam nails that prediction. That's why you're here standing next to me for these type of things.
Not for my singing qualities?
Not for your singing qualities. All your jokes, just the analysis here. Really. Are we going to see Oracle or Phoenix? You think that he challenges the drone count by going Oracle or Phoenixes?
I feel that Hero is more an Oracle player than a Phoenix player. I would definitely not be upset if he plays Phoenixes. I even like it. I think Rain likes it. But Hero is more of an let's just open up with an Oracle and from that point on turn this into a normal game. Keep my opponent at bay, maybe pick up a couple drones. Let's not forget on King Sejong, he got six with an Oracle. I don't think he's going to get six again. But we will see.
Well, he's just left his main base here with a probe, and there's been no really following of that from Jadon, because he hasn't actually built any Zerglings in this game at all. He has decided here, Hero, that is, to go Phoenixes, so he's going to be able to push the initial Overlords away. This probe, straight through the middle, so it doesn't look like he had intentions to build a pylon outside of the realm that Jadon has built himself.
I mean, I really like Phoenix play. I'm a big fan of it. You can always get four or five Phoenixes. It's very hard to lose them, especially if you're as good as Hero. You're just going to fly around, pick up an Overlord or three most of the time, and after that you're going to find a queen that's out of position, that's spreading creep, and then you're going to fly in and spend your energy on a couple of drones. The only thing is that you often give quite a bit of freedom to a Zerg as well, because you know they know that Phoenixes are expensive units, so it's very unlikely that you have a quick Blink Stalker attack or something behind this. So Zerg's just going to drone up. You kind of just be like, with Phoenixes, you basically say, all right, I'll let you do what you want, but the Phoenixes will allow me to do what I want, and I think then in the end it will be better for me.
We are going to see double evolution chamber come from Jadon. He hasn't really got too much scouting information. I think he snuck some Zerglings on to the bottom hand side here. One of them to see if there was a third Nexus or not. And whoa.
Yeah.
Well, that was.
That is actually really important because we see a Robo and a Forge go down. A build that has been popular in the past is a plus one Zealot with War Prism, and then the Phoenixes clear out the Overlords, and then a War Prism flies across the map.
Oh, Zergling goes inside. Yeah. Sees the Robo, sees the additional gateways being added on.
But I don't think he would have ever done it with these spawning locations. That's something you do when you're closer to each other or something on a smaller map. I'd be really surprised if he would have relied on that. So.
Against a three hatch against Jadon, surely by building so much infrastructure without taking a third base, he's falling behind when it comes to the economy.
Yeah, but it's only 8 minutes in the game, though. I don't think we have to panic yet. Like, if you open up with Phoenixes, I actually think that an expand going down between the 9 and 10 minutes is still more than fine for you because your Phoenixes are going to slow him down. Like, 8 minutes and 30 seconds while playing Phoenixes, I think it's still pretty quick for three bases.
Well, Jadon's going to, with no aggression coming out, probably here from Hero, is going to be able to get towards those 1-1 upgrades with his Zergling, and is going to play maybe a Zergling Infestor style, Zergling Ultralist style, so we'll follow that as it goes on. But right, there are a couple of Zerglings waiting to try to cancel a potential third Nexus.
Yeah, this is a very important moment in the game. Hero wants to go up to three bases real soon, and Jadong definitely wants to deny it, preferably more than once, but he wants to deny it. He's up 12 workers now, which is good, but it's not superb, especially not when Hero already has five Phoenixes. Like, this is a 920 Nexus, and he also has plenty of units in position. This is really solid play by Hero. I kind of like how he's been doing this.
And Phoenixes continue to harass Hero. Oh, six of them have killed seven workers.
He actually got the cancel. I don't understand, because there are four or five sentries over there.
I think he wasn't paying attention as we were even watching the Phoenixes lift up drones. 18 more Zerglings being made here, with 1-1 upgrades about to complete. Yep. It seems like Jadong's going to want to try to cancel that Nexus again.
That seems really unlikely. With four gateways, a Colossus halfway down, I don't think there's any world where you can get another cancel. But I'm very, very shocked that he even got the first one. That should not have happened. He had four gateways ready, he had four sentries full of energy. Maybe it even got sniped and he didn't cancel it.
Phoenix has continued to do a lot of damage here. Drones, overlords, queens, whatever they can find at this point. As Hero does try to establish that third base, and it is established at this point. He's finally moved out, he's claimed this area, and of course can start to get the resources from this to continue on to build up his army. Upgrades from Jadong, but the infestation pit's finished. Is it straight to Hive?
Yeah.
Is it Infestus?
I think we are going to see a bunch of Ultralisk in this game with the upgrades that Jadong is currently going for. He, of course, knows that it's often Phoenix into standard Stalkers and Colossus whatsoever. And if there's one thing that truly shuts that down, it's Ultralisk. But now we see Enduring Locust on the production tab as well. And that surprised me a little bit. How do you feel about Jadong's Swarmos on Nimbus?
Yeah, I mean, let's just say Jadong's not the best Swarmos player in the world. I think that's a fact we can all agree on. And cross positions here, going to be very difficult for him to play this out. So I don't know. I don't know what I make of this, Roddy.
Good snipe there, one of the Phoenixes, even at quite a bit of energy. I must say I like Hero's Phoenix play so far, but I feel he could have even been a little more effective with it. It's very difficult macroing up perfectly at home. But often he has a little bit of energy, but he's never truly maxed out. One Phoenix is close to maxing out, but as long as you don't max out, you know, you can use it for four beams, so you can always kill these drones eventually. And Phoenixes are such important units, you really want to keep them around, especially because it gives you such a nice security against Mutalisk as well.
Sorry.
No, you're right. I just want to say, like, you really want to keep him around because Mutalisk are always scary.
I'm pretty sure Hero's thinking about that, actually. He's just run down the Fleet Beacon upon seeing the Spire researching an upgrade here. So
he's like,
Well, just in case, I don't want to lose to any of your silly Mutalisk plays. And also, if you think about it, he hasn't really seen that many gas units. And there's a lot of gas that's been invested, or not really invested into, but, kind of brought in for Jadong.
We've
seen Swarm Hosts, quite a lot of them, too.
Yeah, he could, of course, also use the Fleet Beacon for Tempest, so it has more than just one purpose. He's going to see the Swarm Hosts now for the first time. We'll see what he does with the Fleet Beacon, because in the past, he didn't really show that he was a big fan of airplay against Swarm Host play, at least in the series against Snoot. Man, look at these Phoenixes.
Well, Zerglings go towards investment. The third base. As these Phoenixes go in, and how much damage can Jadong do? He's into the mineral line.
He needs to pull those Zerglings for sure. Those probes for sure, because if he just keeps mining, he's going to lose all of them. I experienced that just the other week. I was like, a few Zerglings in hold position, that won't be that bad. 3 seconds later, I had two probes mining.
Oh, well, Jadong just walks into the main base here. A small mistake from Hero is we're going to see a couple of these probes picked up upon, maybe a structure or two going down. And
these are 2-2 Zerglings, by the way. These Zealots are going to have a really hard time. Just two Zealots. I'm not sure if those Zealots are going to win the fight in the natural. Well, they're on hold position, so they're working more on probes than they are on the Zealots. But look at how many probes being picked up by these silly links.
Yeah, quite a few now in total. Still a pretty decent economy left over for Heroes, 67 workers. A lot of Corruptors have been added into the composition of Jadong now. He's going up towards Hive as well. And his Hero on these three bases is going to take a fourth now, should I say. But what is the game plan here of Hero? What is he looking to do? Just trying to drag it out long, slowly, slow Jadong down a little bit?
I am not sure. I think for Hero, most of all, he wonders, like, Jadong, what are you doing? Are you really going to go full snoot? I don't think you are going to go full snoot on me. That doesn't feel like you. So I think Hero wants to identify what he's truly playing against, then make sure that he gets a solid four base economy going, and then he's going to push as hard as he can with the idea to win the game. There's truly no follow-up behind secure fourth base and push and win. That's what I think.
Well, Mothership Core has been turned into a Mothership here for some cloaking ability on these units to help protect against the waves of Locusts. There is also a Warp Prism that was somewhere on that right-hand side that was threatening to go towards the natural of Jadon, but there are a couple of Spore Crawlers in position.
Man, Hero loves building probes, man. Johan pointed this out in one of the other games where he had 80 probes and only 120 army supply. Now he has 84 probes. That really makes harassing pretty difficult because you also need a main army, you know?
Yeah.
84 probes, that's like almost half of the supply that you can possibly have.
Well, Jadon is going to play a good old Snoop style here. Getting some Vipers in, adding on the static defense, kind of securing the middle of the map, taking the bases on his side.
I still think he's also going to make Ultras eventually, because he has all these Ultra upgrades.
Yeah? Yeah.
But I think he feels like he's not rich enough now. I think that's something you want to do on 5 bases.
Well, Zergling's of course going to be pretty good for running around, maybe counterattacks as well, bringing down Nexuses, so multiple different uses here. The game has slowed down a lot now with this play.
Oh man, this time Hero is switching it up. He is throwing down all these Stargates. I mean, if he's going to make a bunch of Tempests, then I can guarantee you that Genos is going to make Ultras. And Tempests are... I mean, Tempests are good against massive units. The problem is Tempests are pretty slow, and Ultras, and especially Zerglings, are very fast. You see Darkshrine go down as well, so Hero's just doing a little bit of everything right now. He's just rounding up the Protoss tech tree. Doesn't really have any air upgrade, so if he makes Corruptus... Tempest or whatever, they're probably going to lose the fight against Corruptus for quite a while. Like, yes, he has Storm, but that's all he has.
Well, Jadon's minerals are very low as he's continuing to spend all of it in static defense as he, like I said, just kind of cutting the map in half at this point. I wouldn't be surprised to see a second Spire soon to maybe get and further his upgrades for his area. He realizes what he's playing against here is he hasn't actually seen that the Tempest is coming into play. He hasn't seen that this is eventually going to be an air battle between the both.
I really wonder how Jadon feels about that. An air battle while he's already having +2 on the Corruptus. We've seen a couple of very silly games when it comes to Zerg air against Protoss air on this map. Zespa's life is most memorable of the runners we've seen of BlizzCon. That game, like, Zespa's just like losing all the fights and then suddenly he won the game. Like, all right, well, I'll sign for it. I really think that if Hero wants to go all out on these Tempests though, he should get a second Cybernetic score like ASAP.
Well, I think the key locations now is actually these Stalkers, before I talk about key locations, are doing a lot of damage. Yeah. They're not as useful in this game anymore, and they've picked up quite a few work kills. But the key locations here for Jadon to focus on are the expansions. The new expansions, aside from the fourth one, it's this one. And it's maybe one towards the 6 o'clock on the minimap as well that could be taken here by Hero. The creep's been pretty good. Swarmos in the middle. He's got to contest his bases and keep Hero away from keeping his income high.
Just send a couple of Zerglings there to the south side of the map. Make sure he doesn't expand there or put a Zergling on patrol between a few bases. These Stalkers are running straight into their death. And I agree. And then slowly but steady, he can use the Swarmos indeed on the left side over here to start working on these bases. This is where things get pretty interesting. We see Adrenal Glands going down somewhere here in this arena. Day 9 is clapping as loud as he can. He's like, yes, finally!
Vipers definitely be wanting to try to grab that Mothership Core here. Pretty annoying to have the Locust not do anything. Maybe if he's going to edge forward shortly to try that, but there are some High Templar underneath. Could be risky at the same time.
I mean, he's getting shield upgrades as well, but I still want to see his second Cybernetic Core. Otherwise, he's never going to get any armor upgrades, and armor is like pretty important against these Corruptors that are going to be working. This is a funny game because now Hero is just showing us a completely different style than he has shown us earlier today. And I felt like he didn't even really have to do that this game. Like, there was definitely room for his regular, I'm going to try to outplay you with War Prism and Harass, and I'm going to rely on Stalkers, Colossus, and Storm. So we'll see how good he is in controlling this army. I think it's a very difficult Protoss army to control. I've been pretty vocal about this in the past. I know it looks easy, like, you have all these big units that you're sitting there, but it's very awkward. It's so different than what you normally control that you really need a lot of practice with it.
Well, +1 armor now coming in for the Corruptors. A second Spire 2, and of course the Corruptors, multiple purposes. It's easy pick-offs of Warp Prisms from multiple locations where we are going to see Hero try to find areas of weakness behind the enemy lines of Jadon, who has cut this map up now. And a lot of Corruptors, fantastic upgrades. 22 Swarmos, 16 Corruptors, a couple of Vipers in there as well, with some Zerglings to try to contest weakened areas as well.
22 Swarmos is definitely a number that you have to respect as well. Jadon is sacrificing more and more drones and trying to free up some supply. I think Hero is finally going to do the same as he realized that having 83 drone probes is perhaps a little too much in this phase in the game. You want to have more army supply. You want to be able to harass a little bit. This one Colossus is not being cloaked by the Mother Ship.
That umbrella.
Man, he was that one son that never got any love.
Well, this game's going to be a long one here, Rotterdam. It's going to become a game of, kind of money. It's a game of economy. It's who's going to mine out faster, who's going to have money left over.
Money's money, Sean.
Money's money, Roddy. And it's not like either of them can engage into each other. This is the reason why it's going to be a long game here. Hero can't just move forward and attack. There's too much static defense. There's Queens, there's the Corruptors, there's the Swarm Host. And likewise, Jadon isn't going to just march his static defense forward. That is a part of his army in this case.
Yeah, maybe if the Tempest would have ever received their upgrade of doing more damage to buildings, then this would have been all right. But I agree with you. I don't really see a world where our hero is just going to break Jadon now, especially because he's like maxed out. So he, pretty much the only thing he can do is with his main army. And this is not really going to be that quick for a hero, especially because Jadon can just like avoid that army for a bit as well, reposition his Swarmos and do some serious damage somewhere else. A couple of Dark Templars are working on Locust over there as well.
This is just going to be Hero trying to defend while breaking through with Dark Templar maybe. But I really feel that Jadon's got to start to try to take some Tatsu, and he's actually going to try to get those trades now, and he grabs some other shit core. Great stores, by the way.
Wow.
Whoa, beautiful storms coming out from Hero as Jadon does eliminate the Mothership core, or the Mothership, should I say, so there is a timing now where these Locusts can start to get damaged on. Another big grab here from Jadon. 2-3, Tempest get pulled in, and this is where the game starts to be back and forth between these two players with these types of trades.
Yep. Couple of Zealots being wiped in on the right side of the map, but those trades are expensive for Hero. Of course, Hero is a lot more, is a lot richer right now than Jadon currently is, but still, you can't do that too many times, because before you know it, suddenly you're not that rich anymore as a Protoss player. I must say, really quick response by Hero on recalling the Mothership, but somehow Jadon had enough DPS to kill it, despite the instant recall. That kind of surprised me.
All right, well, Zealots and Dark Templars getting to these map bases now. Going to pick off the Spore Crawler, and it's going to come down to maybe an Overseer assisting. But what units, what mobility does Jadon actually have? Is it just Swarmos that he's got to reposition, re-rally?
I mean, he should always have a bunch of Zerglings running around with Overseers, because he has 3-3 upgrades. So Zerglings are very good, and he indeed has enough Swarmos to have a few Swarmos all around. Losing these two hatcheries sucks, obviously larva purposes, but also there were still quite a few minerals left in that base, so now you have to decide on whether or not you want to rebuild a hatchery over there to mine it out in the long haul.
Yeah, Jadon's maybe a mistake here is his Overlord spread's not ideal here. The south side's pretty bad, and towards the north there are some dark areas. And of course, with the Corruptors, you're just wanting to chase down the Warp Prisms all day. And here he is going to be able to pick this one up, hopefully. If it gets too far away, the Vipers can pull it in.
Look at the Overseer count. He's flying around with like 9 or 10 OCs. It's actually kind of fun, because OCs are very annoying. Tempest, of course, don't have very high DPS, so if they would ever shoot on the Overseer or click on an Overseer, they just absorb so much damage.
Well, Hero's got the top left-hand side of this map as his. There's no creep spread. The Locust can't get there fast enough. He's pretty much guaranteed three bases to the top left-hand side.
Couple of Tempest, High Templars. Man, I'm confusing all the units over here, Sean. It's been a long day of StarCraft, and I feel that this series is far from over.
More units really have gotten in here, and this should not be happening. As a Zerg player, you shouldn't be letting any of these units. You've got to be watching them walk across creep and reposition in time, or stop that Warp Prism from happening. And Jadon taking losses that he shouldn't be taking. Another Warp Prism, as you can see there, gets picked off just slightly to the left. Losing the Hive, you're going to start to lose the production of Vipers. It takes a long time to rebuild them.
Yep, and it's an expensive building to lose as well. And Jadon doesn't really have to worry about gas now.
But he uses his drones to actually keep this alive.
In the future, he's going to have to worry about minerals. That's, of course, one of these things. Normally, Zerg play doesn't have to worry about minerals too much. They worry about gas. But with this tower, it's the other way around. This is something that Snoot have been talking about in the past as well. Because you use so much of your resources for static defenses that at a certain point, you're sitting on all this gas. You just can't do anything with it. Other than truly burn it on Infestors if you really want to. But Infestors are just not good in this phase in the game against that army composition.
Another Warp Prism on this right-hand side here, and easy access, and another one to the top left here for Hero to continue the harassment.
A couple of pros being transferred to the left-top side of the map. You see, Hero is like, this is much more Hero, you know, harassing everywhere and stuff. Like, I feel the guy with that Tempest army, that's not Hero. This is Hero, Sean.
He's doing well. I mean, he's continuing to pull Jadonk right and left, and more importantly, force Jadonk's hand when it comes to the money that he's saving up. Always rebuilding this and that and hatchery and defense and maybe a couple of Zerglings to help out, and he's continuing to do it.
Yep, three Spinecrawlers is not going to be enough against these very well upgraded Zergling, Zealots over here on the left-up side. So that hatchery is going to die. Whoa. Again. A couple of Colossus being abducted there. That was a very good trade for Jadonk.
That was a massacre there. Very expensive. And all the work that Hero's been doing over the last few minutes is almost nullified with the expense of those Colossus he just lost.
Man, he has six Stargates now. He's building six Tempest at a time.
Yeah. And that's why, and with this push that we saw there from Hero, that's why we're not going to see too many pushes. Is he moves forward and loses like five, six Colossus without killing anything. It's very difficult to move anywhere.
He wasn't maxed out yet. I think he's very hesitant about deciding what he wants to max out on.
Yeah, maybe he wanted to just get rid of the Colossus to move fully into Tempest.
But I also always think that one or two Colossus is nice to protect your High Templars, because High Templars are very important. Because without Storm, your Tempest are going to lose a fight against Corruptors. I'll guarantee you that.
That's true. All right, well, another attack here from Jadonk with a couple of Zerglings. Not going to be able to do too much here. A simple Warpin's going to push this back. And a Warp Prism is dealt with there. Some Zerglings underneath and the Corruptors coming to pick it off. And Jadonk's starting to stabilize again. No more Warp Prisms, no more harassment, no more Warpins.
Yeah, Jadonk has slowly but steadily secured that base in the 3/4 o'clock position of this map, which is a base I felt that I was never thinking he was going to be able to secure, because there were Warp Prisms flying around everywhere. But his hatch now halfway done, a couple of Spinecrawlers on his way to defend it. If Jadonk gets that base, well, then Jadonk just like saves himself for another 10, 15 minutes in this game.
I think these two styles, these two armies, it's cost-efficient trading, which I don't think we've seen yet from Jadonk, who's meant to be the one winning this all and out, right?
Yeah. Let's take a look at the units lost resource step, just to give us an idea about what's going on. Oh my god.
That's pretty bad, actually.
Yeah, that's pretty bad. I didn't think it was that bad. I know Hero has been harassing a lot, but already lost 12,000 more. It's not the end of the world, because he still has a couple of fresh bases. The mothership gets abducted again, and it will get picked off again as well. A couple of big storms landed on those Corruptors, though, but in the end, Jadonk just doesn't lose that much there. This Tempest number, however, is a very intimidating amount of Tempest.
And the last Colossus is taken out now. We may see a big attack soon from Jadonk if Hero's going to push through here, if he rebuilds and remaxes on as many Corruptors as he can. The Locusts underneath are going to deal with the High Templar, which of course are crucial in helping out versus the large Corruptor fights.
I think Jadonk should take this fight.
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
move forward with the spores.
I think
like,
he might.
Yeah, unburrow all your spores and send your Corruptors in as well.
Yeah, this could be a huge win here for Jadonk if he takes it very shortly. I think he's waiting for his last few Corruptors. He's only 24. It's not a high amount.
I guess he's just waiting for a couple of abducts and he wants to slow and steady wins the race. Let's just be safe. But
more Zealots have made their way down south. They're going to look for some of those bases. Jadonk sends a few Zerglings, which is a little bit obviously frustrating.
That's really frustrating, especially if you're maxed out. And that's what always happens to me. It's like, maxed out. I'm Protoss. I'm supposed to just wipe in units when I get harassed. I don't know how to split up my army.
And picking up a pylon or two back there, just a little bit frustrating. There's Tempest though. I think no matter how many Tempest you get, you're going to lose versus Fallout Corruptors.
Yeah, that's definitely what I thought in that Zest versus Life game, but in the end,
true.
Zest just win it. But in general, I'm not the biggest fan of Tempest, especially not. Oh, a couple of Oracles getting abducted.
One of them survives there. Of course, every unit very valuable at this point is both players starting to run out of resources. That's been the pretty much story of the game here. Resources, running out of resources, maintaining resources.
Yeah, and they have quite a bit of resources and they have mining bases, but...
soon know that every bit counts.
Yep, in 20 minutes from now on, that's not the case anymore. Then suddenly you look at your assimilators, you're like, I have like 1,400 gas left this one, 1,300 gas left there. I can still take that base and that's about it. Oh boy, I have to win this game with less than 4,000 gas left on the map. So as silly as it seems right now when Apollo says, you know, they're worried about resources, in a minute or 15, they will be very worried about the resources.
Zerglings back into the main base again. Another frustrating move here from Jadonk. He's also secured the center of the field. Actually, hold that point. Is a couple of Archons do get pushed in. The Swarm is going to deal with them very easily.
They got abducted, but didn't die. So a little bit mistimed there by Jadonk. He gets a couple of Tempests, though. What? Something.
Quite a few Corruptors do go down. I think pretty nice for Hero.
Yeah, Jadonk's supply suddenly plummeted, Sean. He's only at 150 now. He's going to make 12 more Corruptors.
Got to get rid of that mothership there. Absolutely. He has to get rid of that mothership. He's got to find a way to try to
Man, Jadong suddenly is pretty much broke, Sean. He just spent like 2,400 minerals on the Puroptus. Yeah. And he doesn't have much more than this. Oh. More storms go down.
Great storm there from Hero.
Wow.
I don't know if he's got any Vipers with this, but that Mothership Core has to go.
Good storm there on these Garothas as well, man.
Jadon can't get close. Hero protecting this very nicely with the Archons in there as well, really supporting these Tempests. And he's pushed through the middle. Jadon's running out of resources.
Yeah,
he's actually
in trouble.
In a bit of trouble here.
He's in a lot of trouble, Sean. Like you said, these Archons making it so hard for these Corruptors to get close. There goes the Mothership, but at what cost? The storms again connect with the Corruptors. And Jadon is only at a 131 supply, has 180 minerals in the bank. That's it. He doesn't have more.
He doesn't have much more. And it looks like Hero, pushing through the middle here, has been able to break Jadon's center defensive position. And eventually, after countless attempts and attacks here, Hero looking like he can pick up this and actually take a lead in this series, as Jadon units just left and right dying instantly. And CJ's Hero, all of a sudden, with a 40 supply advantage.
Yep, and money in the bank, and more bases. Oracle does get picked off, but I don't know how Jadon is supposed to survive this. There are still a couple storms left.
Jadon's gonna go for this, but there's storms, there's Archons. And GG calls, he doesn't even engage into it. And Hero goes up 2-1 there, Rotterdam.
They just see it, man. Like, Jadon is not really a swarm host player, pure song, as they like to say. You know, he obviously is capable of executing it. He's capable of running around a little bit with it, and he will defeat lesser Protoss players. But Hero is good. Nimbus is also one of the better maps for Protoss to play against swarm host. I'm not saying it's easy, but he made the best of it. It's very hard for a Zerg to cover all your bases with static defenses, to always have your swarm host in a good position, to be aggressive with your swarm host as well, and at the same time, you know, just take care of everything. There are too many positions that you have to defend. That's why Jadon spent so much money on spine crawlers and spore crawlers whatsoever, and in the end, he had a lot of gas, but he just had no minerals left.
All right, well, we are going to shoot off to a very quick commercial break here, but when we return, can Hero close it out, or can Jadon make the comeback? Welcome back to the Intel Stream Masters San Jose. As we've reached the semi-finals, we're in the first one currently, and CJ Hero, our two-time Intel Stream Masters champion, leads 2-1 versus Jadon. We just concluded a long and epic Swarm Host Corruptor game here, with Hero coming out on top as we get ready to move in to the next game here. What can we take away from this series so far that we've learned about both of these players moving on to the next couple of games?
Just that Hero is obviously solid in this matchup, which we knew. It was kind of hard to see how good he truly was against Zerg when he was going up against Snoot, because Snoot has such a unique style, and he's so much better with Swarm Mode than almost anyone else out there. I'm sure, you know, one or two Korean Zergs also very good with Swarm Mode, but in general, Snoot is one of the absolute best players in the world when it comes to that style, and Hero doesn't get a whole lot of practice against it. We saw that earlier, but now we see when the games are a little bit more standard that Hero is very good. I'm still a little bit confused is a big word, but I don't really get why Jadon prioritized getting the ground upgrade so much when then he never really tried to have a follow-up with it. Just relied on Swarm Mode. Then you may as well just start researching missile attacks all along.
I have to agree with you. I think that maybe the choice of strategy was not the correct one. Why would you use Swarm Mode anyway from that position? It wasn't like you were pushed into that decision. And
not at all.
He could have played Zergling and Infesta, could have played Zergling and Infesta over into Ultralis. Could have had a different set of choices, but that was the one he chose. We'll see if he wants to repeat it. If we've seen before in the past that players like Parting have been able to beat Jadon Swarmer's play, Hero's now beaten it. Maybe that's not the way to victory here for Jadon, as Hero looking like the complete package, defensively, aggressively. He's got timings, he can play the game out long, and is looking like he could move on to the grand final. But here we see Lee Jadon thinking for a little bit here before we jump into the next map. It's going to be Overgrowth, I think. It's either Overgrowth or Catalina, which we'll be jumping into very, very shortly here.
It's funny, because Overgrowth, I think, is a very, very good Swarm Mode map, but we just included as well that that's not really Jadon's style. So if it is Overgrowth, that's a very tricky one, and I think one that's very, very hard to predict. I do think that if Jadon would have gone Swarm Mode and Overgrowth, there's a good chance he would have been successful with it, but it still doesn't mean that I want to see him go Swarm Mode right now. Like, no, I want to see the Swarm, but I have to admit as well, for all the Zerg players out there that are losing their stuff right now, that it is very hard to straight up overrun a world-class Protoss player like Hero on Overgrowth. It's difficult to get some of the engagement going that you're looking for. It's easy to drop force fields, it's easy to go up to three bases. So this can be a very difficult map for Zerg if you don't play Swarm Mode.
Well, we're not too far away from reaching the grand finals here in San Jose, the last large StarCraft II tournament of 2014. Before we take the off-season Christmas break and get ready for 2015, of course, this tournament still joins into the WCS system of 2015 with WCS points on the line. The winner of this guarantees themselves 500 valuable points. Let's see as we load and join Catalina as our first map is up here to the top. And side is the blue Protoss player playing for the Kesper team. CJ enters. It's the two-time Interstream Masters champion. It's Hero!
And on 9 o'clock off Catalina, we have our red Zerg player, of course, representing the Evil Geniuses. I know you guys want to see him advance. Give it up for Jadon. Still a lot of Jadon fans in the house, Sean.
There's also, of course, $25,000 on the line for these players, fighting for their share of it. Guaranteed $2,000 here, being in the semifinals, but of course, everyone wants that extra little bit of dosh, a little bit of cash. As we do have a very early pylon here.
Yep.
From CJ down on his second base here, Rotterdam.
Yep. So this does mean, by the way, that Overgrowth is going to be the fifth map.
That's right.
I don't think
correct.
It was Vida. So we were mistaken on that one. Catalina is an interesting map. It can be difficult for Protoss to go up to three bases on this map as well. I think this is a map that favors Jadon's style a little bit more. It's definitely something where you can run around with Zerglings, run around with Roaches, you know, play Zerg in the way that Zerg was meant to be played. Be active with units all around the map. Maybe even some middleist play. We haven't seen it a whole lot in this tournament, actually.
Jadon tried to get that hatchery first down, and he's been blocked by this probe. It is very close to happening.
Ooh, Forge.
And by the look of it, we do have a Forge coming in here, and Jadon's very insistent on going for this hatchery first here. He's got a lot of money in the bank, and he has not thrown down the spawning pool. He's going to hatch first to the middle of the map here, and with a Forge on its way, is it going to be? Can he still?
He definitely can still, because the spawning pool is not even down yet. This is something, of course, that we know. Hero doesn't know this. And so Hero might not want to cannon rush this other location because he probably thinks like it's getting too late for that. But the opposite is actually true. The spawning pool is so late that even if he decides to go for it right now, I still think he can get cannons up.
All right, well, let's follow that probe here as Jaylon is going to try and throw down his third hatchery very, very early on in this game. Probe is kind of annoying this drone, but doesn't look like we are going to see any intent to cannon from this point as the spawner pool gets closer to finishing here. So Jaylon fans can sigh that one away.
So not really an investment for a hero, other than the fact that the Nexus was a little bit later than it would normally be, but not really an investment for Jaylon either, because he never threw the hatchery down in the natural.
Yeah, he still hasn't got his second base here, or, well, third base, or whatever it is, the natural hatchery and location, and this probe's still here!
500 minerals in the bank for Jaylon. Now he just started his Zerglings and his Queens, but he just really, really wants to get his hatchery down.
And another pylon goes down here for Hero. Delaying Jaylon a lot. That's a good couple of minutes he's been delayed. Well, at least a minute here from this.
Yeah, very frustrating for Jaylon. Obviously pretty cool for Hero and all the CJ Enters Hero fans out there. Is he going to drop a gateway now or something? Something, some pros play, but you don't want to do that when there are four Zerglings out already.
All right, third hatchery down. On the other side of the map, Jaylon is going to scout out the cannon, the gateway cybercore, and of course the Nexus has been planted.
Am I mistaken, or is that a full wall? Or can something squeeze through?
Just there, no?
Yeah.
Just by the pylon, or here.
Okay, in between the pylon and the fort, yeah.
Yeah.
Put an Apollo Zealot there with his broad shoulders.
That's right, man. With my shoulder pads on. Alright, Zergling.
No, it's the bottom.
Okay, it's this side. Maybe it's a double. I don't know.
No. I guess the camera was just tricky when it was angled.
Okay.
Flo's right. Trying to trick us, making us look bad throughout the entire weekend.
She makes us look amazing.
I know.
Without her, we'd be all over the place. I think we already are most of the time, but... Alright, double guesses coming in here from Jaylon. Likewise, we've just seen the setup of a regular two-base Protoss, and as the Cybernetics core is completed, and it has done, we can see the tech choice, which looks like it's going to be a Stargate at the back of the base here for Hero.
This time I think it's going to be an Oracle again. I get more of an Oracle feeling at Catalina than I get at any other map. I think this is a really good map to open up with an Oracle. It's going to arrive at the mineral line pretty quickly, so maybe the spore is not even done yet. And for Phoenixes, I find it's a less ideal map, because if you throw a bunch of spores down, often this game will come down to a timing at the third base or the fourth base anyway.
Yeah.
And opening up with four or five Phoenixes, I'm not going to say that it's bad, because I never think the Phoenixes are bad, but it definitely opens you up to certain Hydra timings, especially if Zerg players cut a corner or two. Now that's an interesting roach one.
It's also interesting that Jaylon's mining so heavily in gas too. And I think it's a very large gas income for this stage of the game here. Already at 150 gas banked. Mm-hmm. Roach Warren down here, does he have any tricky plans up his sleeve?
And let's not forget that in a couple of the previous games, he even went layer before starting Zergling speed
four
as well.
Four Overlords on the way. He's going to go for a Zergling Roach attack here up this natural. Yep.
And it's going to be an Oracle first for our Hero. Oh. If he uses all of his energy on the Queen or on drones, that will actually not help him out defensively. But of course, Oracles are very good in identifying that stuff like this is happening. Three more gates going down as well, Apollo.
This could be the end of the semi-finals here if Hero's able to fend this attack. The first way to be able to defend it is, of course, identifying the fact that this is happening. The Oracle is the unit to try to figure this build out. He's going to come down. There's hardly any drones on this natural, and already you've got to start wondering, why the hell does he have no drones here? What the hell's going on? What are in those lava racks? He sees the roots. He's incredibly early on and already has a Void Ray on its way. This surely cannot work for Jaylon.
Nope. Now Hero, of course, is definitely not pressured to go up to three bases. Why would you go up to three bases when you see your opponent has no drones in his natural and he just made 12 or 13 roaches?
He's on top of cannon. Four gateways, Void Ray cannons, sentries, force fields, everything on the way. Jaylon already evacuating the plan. He's got drones on the way. Some Zerglings do sneak in that see the preparation from Hero on its way. The lair has been put down, but these roaches aren't going to do anything.
They might be able to do something. They're not going to win the game, but not anything. There's still quite a few roaches, and they keep the Oracle at home. Maybe get the...
Oh, look at that. He keeps and traps these roaches in. The Void Ray goes to work.
I'd go for the Forge. I think he would have been able to get the Forge if he just starts working on it. Like, all of these roaches were in range of the Forge, working on these cannons. I don't think it's very, very successful.
Very well done there from Hero. Nice and calm. He knew what he was up against in plenty of time. Had a lot of thinking time. And from this point on, Hero is taking a good lead. As you can see, 1,700 resources lost for Jaylon in this game just at the 9-minute mark compared to 500.
Oh.
A great start here for Hero as he looks closer and closer to making his fourth Intel Extreme Masters Grand Final.
Yeah, that's a ridiculous performance by Hero. We often speak about it, how hard it is to be consistent in the Soccer 2 scene and make it to four tournament finals of just a certain tournament circuit. This is not even all the tournaments around. It's just one circuit, the Intel Extreme Masters. That is incredible consistency by Hero, especially because he makes it not off the back of invites. No, he makes it through qualifiers. Has to beat a whole lot of good players to even get here.
All right, well, Hero, very close to closing this one up. And there's Jadon gonna make the comeback possible. He needs to make the comeback in this series. He needs to make a huge comeback in this game. He's at 64 workers, of course, very comfortable at this point. Hydralis down on the way. He's a little bit behind in his upgrades, his timing really with the Hydralis. If you think back to King Sejong Station, for example, the Hydralis attack is almost happening at this time. They've only just started to be built. The upgrades are very far away. This is going to allow Hero to have that plus two attack completed by the time an assault happens. The blink as well. It's a very comfortable position here for Hero.
Yep, Hero knows that the ball is definitely in his corner and that he's in a good position. He's in the driver's seat, as they like to call it, and all he has to do is just defend a little bit, get plus two ready, get blink ready. He could drop a robotics facility with a Robo Bay, but it's not even mandatory. As long as he just relies on these gateway units with the economy that he's had, these Phoenixes, did they see the Hydras marching across the map?
I'm not sure they did, but they are on their way. And this attack could potentially get Jadon back into the game here if Hero doesn't take this fight well. If he misses up the force fields, he doesn't really see where this is coming from.
What's the income tap?
Well, he's going to have a quick look at this army. He already sees the Hydralis, and there's not too much units here.
Modest
for Hero. He's going to be very careful. Two force fields trap these Hydralis. Now Hero has time to pull back, set up his defense. He's got plus two, he's got blink, he's added on more units.
It's still doable indeed for Jadon, especially because the start of that fight went pretty well. Yep. He got a sentry, got a stalker or something like that. And this is a tricky position with sentries and blink stalkers, but blink is ready. The first set of force fields is good, Sean.
That's pretty good. He's been able to trap himself back and keep away most of the Zerg. And he's got to continue to do that. He does have quite a few force fields left, but he's using five or six at a time. Jadon's starting to push through the ranks. He's getting a couple of these units. Still, 20 supply lead, but is the defense going to continue on? It should do it this point as reinforcements instantly into the fight, but no more force fields.
No more force fields, but also no more Zerg units over here, Sean. It's just four or five very, very sad Hydralis for Jadon. Two Roaches are going to die as well, and Hero knows now that he's in such a phenomenal position. He did that well, by the way. It would have been easy to mess that up, let the Hydras get too close to your sentries. Before you know it, you have no Guardian Shield, you have no force fields anymore. But he didn't do that. He put his units on hold position, micro the stalkers very well, and from this point on, you know, this Protoss army, despite him still being down 20 supply, Hero's in a really, really good position. Of course, you know, don't overcommit, don't take a very stupid, silly engagement.
Yeah.
But normally, Protoss should not mess this up.
24 Roaches. There's about to be roughly similar amounts of Hydralis as well, but we do have plus three attack on the way.
Yeah,
a lot of units here and a lot of force fields. A Warp Prism in pursuit as well to help with the reinforcements. Hero looking to see if he can close this one up to move on to the grand finals. He can trap units coming from the south. He jumped forward. He wants to win this. He's looking to do this. And he's going to take this fight into Jadon. There's a lot of Jadon units. He's going to get the Warp Prism from behind.
That's
and
sick.
Hero actually gets pushed away from this.
That's actually really sick. Sniping the Warp Prism and that forward blink was very, very questionable. Hero is suddenly down 30 supply. Jadon chasing these units up the ramp, picking off sentries left and right, picking off a stalker as well. Jadon, you were supposed to be close to death.
He was meant to be close to death there, and Hero over eager. Blinking forward here is... You can see Jadon now in pursuit. 11 more Hydralis on the way. That plus three attack not yet done. The robotics bay as an emergency structure coming in. How is this turned around?
I don't know, Sean. I don't know, but I think the people over here are loving it, and I would love to see another game five. We're not there yet because that is a big Zealot warp in.
Yeah, big Zealot
warp.
Jadon
has to be careful as well, of course, because being over-eager is not a very good thing to do in this game.
Yeah.
So for now, he's being pushed back, but that still went so much better than it normally goes.
And is Hero going to blink forward aggressively again? He does. Jadon turns around to fight this. And yeah, these Zealots not really assisting too much into this. Jadon micro and these Hydralis back, trying to break down the Zealots so we can get to the Stalkers, and he will hold this position in the center of the map. 15 additional
Roaches, plus two attack on the way.
The Mothership Core is full on energy, I assume. Yeah, it must be. Warprism leaving with four Zealots. Like, yeah. Hero has minerals, but he doesn't have gas. He should have been taking a forward base during all this. I just think that he thought, I am not going to need a forward base. This is my game. Everything is going so well for me, and I really can't blame him for it, because I thought the same.
106 supply here. This army could get caught off. The Roach and Hydral is coming from the right-hand side here, and Hero's got to be so careful. He blinks up that rapid. He knows that he's in a bit of trouble. His units are caught out of position. Jadon marches forward here. He's kind of waiting for this army to come down. He doesn't have enough energy to recall. He's going to fight into this. Yeah. And the sandwich, Jadon's waiting for that army to come down. He takes off the forge. He gets rid of that plus one armor. And plus two attack for Jadon about to complete. Hero, in desperation, puts that warp prism into his opponent's third base. And still, he can't come to defend.
No, but like, Hero should start going real soon. I know he's waiting for his Colossus, but he's forced to fight. There's just fighting happening all over the place now. Zealots on the left side of the map. Roaches and Hydras here against these Stalkers. But Guardian Shield, Force Field's going down. Hero is handling this very, very well. But where is this Colossus?
The Stalkers have to retreat. They're going to try and blink away here. They do go to the natural.
Really good.
And he gets back towards his Colossus, who stays alive in this game. And Hero continues to hold on to this. The Warp Prism has done so much damage. The counterattack, as that seems like Jadon really put everything into this assault. Yeah. A very close game when it really shouldn't have been. And that hatchery goes down, and that is a big blow to Jadon's economy, who has continued. Warp Prism harassment continues on.
Yep, warping in a bunch of Zealots on the left on the side of the map. I cannot believe how well Hero handled that, because he was looking at three locations at once, but somehow he was able to do it. Jadon fighting the majority of Hero's army with not enough units, I felt. I think he should have just shoved everything into the bases. Go into the natural, go into the third base, and let the units funnel up.
It looks like Jadon's going to try one last assault. Hero just has to hold on for one more time. There's two Colossus with a third one on the way. This is going to be the final fight of the game, as Hero looks like he's going to be able to move on to the grand finals as he edges this attack back one more time. Still, Jadon without a third, without a probe. Hero's continuing to rebuild up.
Ah, a bunch of free probes over there, because there is a full wall, I think, on the right side, so these probes have to travel via the low ground.
There's a third Colossus in the mix now, dealing out so much damage. There's not a lot of protection, but a big warp in here, as a lot of sentries and Zealots come to buffer up, and the force fields are pretty good. Hero just needs to protect the Colossus. One of them goes down, he can still work with two, though, and he is going to work with two, and he clears up one last assault from Jadon. GG's call. And Hero is our first grand finalist, and he makes his fourth appearance in an Intel Extreme Masters grand final.
Beautiful game there, beautiful series by Hero, very well deserved. Almost threw the way on Catalina there with that forward blink, and of course that brilliant snipe on the Warp Prism by Jadon, but in the end, the way that he defended that one big moment where it really looked like Jadon started to take control of the game and it looked like the army was caught out of position, Hero handled that so well. And that during all that, you can think of harassing with your Warp Prism and sending in Zealots to a base, then you are an amazing Protoss player, Sean. Then you are truly, truly an amazing Protoss player.
Hero reaches his fourth final of 2014. A very successful year for him, as he moves on to the Intel Extreme Masters, guarantees himself 500 WCS points, incredibly vital for the 2015 WCS run, of course, guaranteed $4,000 too, but more importantly, has a chance to fight for another, for his third Intel Extreme Masters championship.
Yep, and there's a chance that it's again going to be against a Protoss player as well, because of course, once upon a time, he played in the final against SOS, he played in the final against Zest, and he played in the final against MC in Sao Paulo. Man, Hero and PvP finals.
Some of them go well, some of them go wrong.
Yes.
Of course, fantastic performances here from both players. Our next semi-final is not too far away, as Bomber will be taking on Rain to see if he can try to find himself another final of 2014, and Rain looking for that PvP. Final thoughts here, as we had the last couple of moments of this game and both players' reactions.
I know Jadon was on the ropes at this point after losing that hatchery, but yeah, this attack was not the best one. And you can definitely see a big sigh of relief there by Hero, and Jadon obviously a little disappointed. I still thought it was a very cool series, a very interesting dynamic series with a lot of cool moments in the games. I still think that Jadon is definitely going to second guess himself about the Swarm host on Nimbus. Yep. It's really funny because Life, that I also don't think is a fantastic Swarm host player on Nimbus, keeps going Swarm host on Nimbus as well. And now we see Jadon do it too. Well, even Snoot lost with Swarm host on Nimbus, and you know, when it comes to Swarm host, Snoot knows his stuff. So, kind of interesting. interesting that we see players that don't go swarm modes on Overgrowth do it on Nimbus. Like, I know Nimbus is a difficult map against Protoss because they can go up to three bases, but there are still a lot of things that Protoss has to worry about as well. So, funny the way that it played out, but overall, I really enjoyed this series.
Well, congratulations to CG Hero as he makes his fourth Intellectual Masters Grand Final. He's on stage with Smix for his winner's interview.
Thank you very much, Sean. Congratulations on our first grand finalist here at Intel Extreme Master San Jose, Hero. Hero, as soon as you came out of that booth and I walked towards you, all I heard you say over and over was, "Ah, this was so hard. Ah, this was so difficult." Can you elaborate a little bit more on what you mean by that?
제가 보자마자 아 힘들다 이렇게 계속 얘기를 하셨는데 정확히 무슨 뜻인지 좀 설명해 주세요.
여기 와서 시차 적응을 좀 못 해가지고 오늘 3시간 자고 와가지고 좀 힘든 것도 있고 아까 전에 스누트 선수랑 했을 때 스누트 선수한테도 적응을 못 해가지고 너무 힘든 경기 해가지고 지금 계속 너무 힘든 경기에서 그냥 여러 가지로 복합적으로 힘든 것 같아요.
So he says it is a couple of things. The first thing is that I'm still a little bit jet lagged from flying all the way from Korea. And so I would say my condition isn't completely great, especially because I was only able to sleep 3 hours last night. And to add on top of that, I'm still not fully recovered from that series against Snoot. It was such a difficult series where I had a really hard time adapting to his style. And then this series as well wasn't the easiest. I just feel like everything has been very difficult for me thus far. And speaking of this series, that last game actually seemed a bit scary for you, even though it was you were at such a huge advantage. Can you tell us more about what happened there?
일단 그 이번 이재동 선수와 마지막 경기도 약간 엄청 유리하다가 좀 위험해 보였는데 그 경기에 대해서 좀 더 얘기해 주세요.
제가 성격 때문에 그런지 모르겠는데 방심을 되게 잘해요. 그리고 제가 되게 결승을 가고 싶었는데 딱 이것만 이기면 결승 간다 이런 생각 너무 들어가지고 너무 기뻐가지고 막 흥분했던 것 같아요.
So Hero says, I think this may be a little bit of a personality thing with my personality, but I definitely have a tendency to lose focus easily. And the game was so close. All I could think was if I just win this game, then I'm in the grand finals. And I was getting a little bit caught up in that fact. And I lost focus. And I think that's why the game went as dangerous as it did, despite the fact that I had such a huge advantage. And speaking of being in the grand finals, now that you're there, there are two people that might come up to join you. It's going to be Rain or Bomber. And I know you've repeatedly talked about Rain, but how do you feel about your chances against either one of them?
이제 마지막으로 이제 결승전을 가게 됐는데 정윤효 선수나 아니면 최주성 선수를 만나게 될 건데 그 상대들 대해서 어떻게 생각하세요?
윤정이랑 되게 친하거든요. 근데 윤정이가 떨어졌으면 좋겠어요. 걔도 아마 방금 전에 저 떨어지기 기도하면서 봤을 것 같아요. 제가 푸푸전을 지금 세 종족전 중에 제일 못하는 것도 있고 윤정이가 잘하는 것도 있어서 좀 까다로운 상대인 것 같아요. 윤정.
So he says, I do need to get this straight. I'm very, very close to Rain. He's a very close friend of mine. That being said, I really hope he drops down and doesn't make it to the grand finals. And I bet you that as he was watching my semifinal series, that he was hoping that I would drop down too. And it's not a personal thing. It's just that personally for me, out of the three matchups, I struggle with PvP the most. So he's going to be a difficult opponent. And I'm sure that Rain feels the same way. So he obviously is hoping for Bomber to advance, but we'll see what happens in our next semifinal match. Congratulations again, Hero, on making it to the grand finals. We're going to head back to the desk with Red Eye.
Thank you very much, Sue. And congratulations to CJ Enters Hero, who breaks yet another record here at the Intel Extreme Masters. He becomes the first man ever to reach 4 Intel Extreme Masters Grand Finals in StarCraft history. An incredible feat. No one else has even reached 3 before until he did it. MC, the only man who have reached 2. Gents, fantastic achievement from Hero. But I want to start off by talking about Jadong first. Just having put up a terrific fight through the tournament and reached a semi-final, do you think that's a satisfactory record for him at this particular tournament?
I mean, obviously getting as far as he did is a fantastic achievement, but, you know, I always have to feel for a player who just finishes an epic series and has to play again. I mean, it's very uncommon, but this was one of those times where Jadon really pushed it to the limit in those games against Bumiho, and he seemed fatigued in the last series.
Yeah, Apollo mentioned it earlier on that all of the matches, all of the matchups that when we looked at the quarterfinals looked very close. You could call them either way.
Yeah.
And guess what? Three of the four quarterfinals finished 3-2, and they were almost very epic. You know, all of them were very epic. And then coming into a semi-final, a very long match again for him, it does take its toll.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, like, I was very, very surprised at the Jadon that we actually saw during this tournament. Because the past couple of tournaments that I've watched him at, it's Jadon. Yeah, he's able to bring out good games, but not quite as good as what we've seen here. I think, you know, Gumiho really gave him a run for his money. And then likewise, Hero really gave him a run for his money. But Hero, one of the best protoss in the world, so you can't really fault Jadon for losing
it. It's a phenomenal achievement. You're a former Intel Extreme Masters winner, of course, back in Warcraft 3, back in 1867. And Hero's now on his verge of playing in his fourth Intel Extreme Masters final. It's a huge achievement when you come to these global tournaments like this.
Yeah, definitely. It just goes to show how much consistency he has and how much he cares, I guess, about this tournament in particular, because every time he attends, he does so well.
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay, let's check in with the brackets and show you exactly how things are shaping up here in San Jose. CJ enters Hero, becomes the first man into the grand final. As we said earlier on, it's his fourth final at the Intel Extreme Masters out of 5 appearances. And he will play the winner of Rain versus Bomber, which is our next matchup. We are headed towards a commercial break, but a quick reminder for you as well, we do, of course, still have the MVP voting open right now on facebook.com/IEM. Of course, we call it the Sick Nerd Baller Award. Plenty of previous winners have the shoes and all of the goodies to go with it. Who's going to be added to that list? It's your decision. Head over to facebook.com/IEM and make sure you do your voting. Also, don't forget, we also have crowdfunding this season, season 9 of Intel Extreme Masters. You can help out, get more money to the players, and go to newegg.com/IEM if you are in the market for some hardware. And anything that you buy on that site, on that link, a percentage of those sales will go to the crowdfunded amount of money at the World Championship in March 2015. We'll be playing the World Championship, of course, once more in the Spodek Arena in Katowice. Time for a quick break now. When we come back, though, it'll be our second semi-final, and it's Bomber going head-to-head with Rain.